I am closing the introductory part and now I'll open the session for questions.
Alright, thank you Dr. Deepak for covering it very briefly. As you can see, it was more of a teaser to, you know, get some questions coming in. And I have been looking at the chat and I've got some questions here for you. So Dr. Deepak, the first question here is from Sudeep. And he's been asking that he tries to plan his daily activities in advance, but unforeseen tasks always upset my schedule. So what are your suggestions on this? So I think this is in relation to the module on time management. So Dr. Deepak,
time management.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh, for posing this question, which was addressed by Sudeep.
Yeah, Sudeep.
Now, this is a situation which will appear and which will happen in any laboratory anywhere in the world. We do plan our work in advance, but then there are emergencies or there are changes in work schedule, and all the plans have to be rescheduled. So if you have planned your work in advance, maybe a day before, and you are ready to carry out the processes, the procedures the same next day, and there are interruptions or changes, you will be geared to accommodate those changes because of your planning. So I think it requires a bit of adjustments, and a person who can plan his work will always come out with some solutions which will be successful.
That's great. I would also like to add here that if you go through the book Getting Things Done, he gives a wonderful thing that you need to maintain a list and always write down what all tasks you have, not only in the lab but also your personal life. And I personally feel, we are always getting new work and more emails coming in, and phone calls, so many things coming. So it's very difficult to, have a fixed plan and say, okay, I will get all of this done today. But it's more important to have your picture clear, have all your questions and all your work cut out and written down in front of you, so you don't miss out on anything. You can always prioritize based on what is coming to you in the day and keep on tackling those things while still remembering what you actually had to do. All right. The second question we've got here is from Stephen, coming in from the chat right now. He's asking, which methods should we rely on, textbook methods or methods from scientific journals?
Dr. Deepak. I personally feel that whatever you come across in textbooks is very basic, and the methods which are given in textbooks are suitable for mostly pure compounds. But in real life samples, the samples can be a bit more complicated matrix. So there you have to devise a method, but you can use these textbooks methods as a guideline. So the other option is to refer to journals where specific methods have been developed based on textbook methods for analysis of particular matrices. And whatever method, even if you rely on a method given in a journal, it needs to be validated to suit your individual requirements, like concentration levels, the type of matrix, sample matrix, and extraction, and all those things have to be at that time. You have to consider these and then develop your method and get it validated before you put it into practice.
Great. We've got lots of questions coming in. Next question is from Malson. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. He's asking that I have worked in a QC lab in Africa where a regional validated method needs no further validation in my lab. What do you think about this? So Dr. Deepak, I'd like to answer this question directly, in fact.
Sure.
See, that is true. Many times there are validated methods. There could be even standard methods that could not need full validation. But the extent of validation can be reduced. You cannot do away with validation altogether. A certain level of verification would be, at least required. Like, you could run just one calibration curve, some spike samples, recovery samples, and that would be good enough. or if the method has built into it some system suitability testing, like running multiple replicates of the standard and then back calculating some QC samples, that is also sometimes sufficient. So you can't totally do away with validation. There can be a variation in the extent of validation that you perform depending on the kind of methods which you are using. So for example, if you are following pharmacopeial methods, usually a verification of the method is good enough. So I hope I've answered your question. So another question we've got from the chat, this is from Dinesh. He's asking, why do we need constant temperature control when using a RI detector? Very good question. Dr. Deepak, please.
Yes, sure. Now, we have to first of all understand the operation principle of RI detector. Now, RI detector will sense changes in refractive index of the mobile phases as it is passing through the detector. So, the refractive index will be again dependent upon the composition. So with the eluting compounds coming in a sequence one after the other, there is bound to be a change in refractive index. So this change is detected by the detector, RI detector. Now, as all of it's from basic physics, it's clear that refractive index is temperature dependent. So we have to maintain constant temperature when we are using the refractive index detector.
Okay, great. So it's because refractive index is very sensitive to the variation in temperature. So Dinesh, I hope we've answered your question there. Then we've got one more question. It's from Mr. Manoj. He's asking, how do I ensure that the HPLC configuration offered by supplier will meet my requirements? So, Dr. Deepak, please go ahead.
Yes. So, one has to be very careful when you get a proposal for HPLC, because HPLC, as I mentioned earlier, is not a tailor-made plug-and-play system. It has to be configured. So, you should get the configuration from the supplier as per your application requirements. Sometimes I do not blame any particular suppliers, but they have a tendency to match the configuration as per your available budget. So either they will overquote or they will underquote. So you have to be very clear on your individual requirements, and then only you can be sure what you have been quoted is meeting your application needs.
Okay. I would also like to add here that if you are lucky enough to have a sample of what you are going to be analyzing routinely on the system, it makes sense to go and do a joint analysis or a demo analysis of your own sample in the lab. So theoretically a configuration might work, but it's possible you'll end up with a system in your lab which is not able to do the analysis. So I personally believe when I am buying any instrument, I like to go with my samples to the lab of the instrument supplier and make them analyze it using the method I'm going to be using and look at the results. It's only once I'm satisfied with the results that I go ahead with the purchase. So I hope, Manoj, that answers your question. Okay, we've got another question coming in that I have seen a lot of methods online and in standard books also, and I have noticed that mostly they use a UV detector. Why is it so? Why is UV most widely used detector? Dr. Deepak?
Yes. UV detector has a characteristic of absorption. Most of the organic compounds have strong absorption bands in the UV region, and particularly at 254 nanometers. So this is one wavelength which you will come across in a number of applications. So this is the main reason why most of the HPLC units are using a UV detector.
Okay, so that's because a lot of compounds have UV chromophores and absorption. They will be detected. Okay, great. We have another question here. it's related to troubleshooting, though we'll be covering troubleshooting in the future modules, but still we can take this question. That this is from Megan. Megan is asking that they're having a lot of columns choking in their lab. So I think that's she's trying to ask about column pressure going up. So what are the most common causes of column pressure going up?
So there are several causes of column pressure going up, but the common reasons for the column pressure exceeding would be choking of the column, and choking can be due to or there may be some voids created because of air bubbles if the mobile phase is not properly degassed, and there could be some solids which are not filtered. There are no inlet filters provided in the solvent bottles, or the mobile phase may be